Even your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer.
Amen.
together.
Come, O Christ, and stand in our midst, as you did stand in the midst of your disciples, and speak to us words of peace.
Peace to each woman, peace to each man, peace to each family, peace to each child, peace to the creatures, peace to the nations, peace to our hearts, peace in our world.
Come, O Christ, and stand in our midst, as you did stand in the midst of your disciples, and speak to us words of peace.
Come to us from the heart of God. Come to us from the garden of our beginning. Come to us from the center of this moment. Come to us from the true depths of our soul.
Come, O Christ, and stand in our midst, as you did stand in the midst of your disciples, and speak to us words of peace.
God be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Grant us, Lord, not to be anxious about earthly things, but to love things heavenly. And even now, while we are placed among things that are passing away, to hold fast to those that shall endure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
A reading from the book of Amos. Hear this, you that trample on the needy, and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great, and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read in unison Psalm 113. Hallelujah.
Give praise, you servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be blessed from this time forth forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its going down, let the name of the Lord be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who sits enthroned on high, but stoops to behold the heavens and the earth? He takes up the weak out of the dust, and lifts up the poor from the ashes. He sets them with princes, with the princes of his people. He makes the woman of the child's house to be the joyful mother of children.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to Timothy. First of all, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for everyone, for kings and all who are in high positions, so that they may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and dignity. This is right and is acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of truth. For there is one God, there is also one mediator between God and mankind, Christ Jesus, himself human, who gave himself a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. For this, I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I'm telling the truth, I am not lying. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is Lord. With many a not heavy. He's my brother.
Said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer.' Then the manager said to himself, 'What will I do now that my master is taking the position away from me? I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes.' So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. He said to him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, And how much do you owe? He replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, Take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise Christ our Lord.
Please be seated. In children's Christian education, there is a curriculum that is called Godly Play. It's a wonderful way of telling Bible stories that invites children into the story so that they can make it their own. And you pull out a box and you tell the story. The children sit very quietly in this little circle around you. And as you tell the story, you are also kind of building the story with elements that come out of each of the boxes. And the story that you're sharing is a parable. You bring out a large gold box containing the elements of this story. And you tell the children, the parable is like this gold box. Because parables are a gift from Jesus that are precious, like gold. Parables have lids that have to be removed. I like that part. And parables have to be unpacked and assembled. Well, folks, we have a doozy of a gold box this evening, don't we? Well, we have heard from Luke's gospel among the more enigmatic of the parables of Jesus, the parable of the dishonest manager. Talk about your lids, right? And how in the world do we unpack this gilded box? Well, a helpful rule of thumb when encountering a difficult text from the Bible is to see where it is situated in the Gospels. What's its neighbors? What comes immediately before it and after this passage? Now, immediately following this passage, we hear Jesus offer some sayings as explanation. If you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust you the true riches? And no slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Okay, this is one lens through which we are to understand this parable. You cannot serve the two masters of God and wealth. So Jesus gives us this parable about a rich man who entrusts his property to a certain steward, and the manager is to use the given wealth to serve his master. Early on, we discover that the manager has failed at this. We hear that he has squandered what has been given to him. Evidently, he has done so dishonestly. The master himself says as much. We don't get the details of his transgressions, but it seems that the manager has turned the serving of wealth as a means to making himself rich. In the course of doing so, he has lost relationship with his master. He's lost his job. He's been fired, terminated. When the rich man demands an accounting of the manager's activities, well, the manager panics. We're allowed access to his interior thoughts. An inner dialogue ensues. I can't toil at the ground. I'm too proud to beg. So he comes up with a plan. Now you and I might perhaps expect that he would artificially increase the amount of money that others owe this rich man so that the manager might accumulate more money to pay back for what was squandered. But he has something else in mind here. He shifts the focus from money as a way of making himself rich to using money to create goodwill for himself and for the rich man. He cuts one debt by 20%, another by 50%. We're told he does this so that he will have a home to be welcomed into. He is creating home. Now, one of the more puzzling aspects of this parable is the rich man's attitude. He's almost joyous as he commends this manager's actions. Again, we might think that the rich man would throw the scoundrel in jail for compounding the squandered wealth by allowing the lower payback by his debtors. Instead, the manager is rewarded. There's something unexpected and strange about this rich man. Indeed, there is something unexpected and strange about both men. To get a better handle on these two characters, we might do well to check out the neighbor on the other side, the scripture that comes immediately before this passage, which, as it turns out, is the parable of the prodigal son, of which I spoke last week. And when we compare the two parables, we find interesting parallels between these two. In both, there are two main characters, there's a power differential between the two. The rich man has authority over the manager, and the father has authority over the prodigal son. In both parables, something of great value has been entrusted to the manager and to the son, and in both, Luke uses exactly the same word to describe what they've done with it. They've squandered this wealth. Both the son and the manager, quote, come to themselves, they become aware of what they have done, and they both have an inner dialogue about what they are to do. They both end up with a home to go to, based on new relationship. The lost son comes to home in new relationship with his father. In fact, the father says those words, my son was lost, now he's found. He was dead, now he's alive. The dishonest manager, he creates home by reducing the debts of those who owe the rich man. He builds relationship. And perhaps by placing these two parables side by side, Luke is asking us to see the manager and the prodigal son as parallel characters, as are the rich man and the prodigal son's father. Just as the parable of the prodigal son is all about the primacy of relation above everything else, so too the parable of the dishonest steward is also about relationship. It's just set in a different context, the context of wealth. By reducing the debt of the debtors, the manager stops serving his own hunger for wealth and begins serving the debtors, the rich man, and eventually himself. And he's commended for using his God-given shrewdness to build relationship. Jesus is teaching us about the kingdom of God. And we can see right away that the kingdom of God is nothing like a Fortune 500 company. God's spreadsheet looks altogether different from that of Amazon or GM. God's currency is relationship. God's currency is covenant. God's currency is love. And God intends the wealth of our world to build up godly and human relationships that are defined by trust and love and understanding and equity. When we serve wealth, we cut away at the roots of relationship. When we serve wealth, we have a community of one. When we use wealth to serve God, we build a community of endless possibility. We struggle with this, though, don't we? Both in society and in church with a capital C. Our society embraces a philosophy of scarcity. There's not enough. There never is enough. There's not going to be enough. I need more, more, more. Scarcity is the fuel that drives our country. And this philosophy surely and certainly creeps into the church with a capital C, which was founded almost 2,000 years ago on a theology of abundance. Perhaps money more than anything else has the potential to stymie and fragment what should be that community of endless possibility. Jesus is calling us to make a decision. Are we to serve wealth? Are we to use wealth to serve God? Serving wealth says, pile it high, because you never know. Using wealth to serve God says, spread it broadly and lift up the burden of others. He ain't heavy. He's my brother, right? Serving wealth says, what? We spent X amount of money on electricity last month? Using wealth to serve God says, with our electricity, we worship God, we study God's word, we prepared soup for our Father's kitchen. We sang glorious hymns. We collected food for impoverished families for Thanksgiving. We shared a meal at this rail every single week. Serving wealth asks at pledge time, how much can I afford to give? Using wealth to serve God asks, in the midst of my abundance, what is my daily bread? What is my enough? And then what is beyond? St. Gabriel's Episcopal Church, where I served as a rector for 8 years before coming to Redeemer, St. Gabe's was a founding member of the South Hall County Food Pantry, along with three other small churches. We gave a week's worth of non-perishable food to whomever showed up. And we did this on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and on Saturdays. And the food pantry was completely supported by these four small churches. Early on, I spoke with a woman who pretty much ran this food pantry. She had been there from the very beginning. And I was curious about this practice that she had. She would talk about this at our board meetings, about her goal at the very end of the year was to have the shelves completely empty and the bank account at near zero. When I asked her about this, she said, well, why would we have money in the bank when there are empty stomachs out there? Every year we start at zero. Every year God provides. I've been doing this for 20 years, she said, and God never fails. She was my primer on scarcity and abundance and faith. God never fails. The parables of Jesus are largely about invitation, inviting us to live into the strange and unexpected kingdom of God, both individually and as a community of faith. The common theme in the parables of Jesus is relationship, fostering, tending, growing, living love. And you know, at Redeemer, we do relationship very well. None of us know where God will lead us in the weeks, months, and years to come. But may we continue in a posture of abundance as we walk boldly into the world as that little red church with the great big heart. Always for the honor and glory of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Our God is the God of all humans, the God of heaven and earth, the God of sea and rivers, the God of sun and moon, the God of all heavenly bodies, the God of the lofty mountains, the God of the lowly valleys. God is above the heavens, and he is beneath the heavens. Heaven and earth and sea, and everything that is in them, such he has as his abode. God inspires all things, gives life to all things, stands above all things, and stands beneath all things. God enlightens the light of the sun, strengthens the light of the night and the stars, makes wells in the arid land and dry islands in the sea, and places the stars in the service of the greater gods. God is a Son who is co-eternal with himself, and similar in all respects to himself. And neither is the Son younger than the Father, nor the Father taller than the Son. And the Holy Spirit reigns in him. And the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit are inseparable. Amen. I invite your prayers now, either silently or aloud. I invite your prayers of thanksgiving. For what and for whom are you thankful?
For each other.
It's beautiful music. It's gathering. I invite your prayers of healing. For whom shall we pray for healing? I lift up Jenny, Stan, Margaret, Steve, Scott, Lewis, Lynn and Jackie, Carolyn, Ben, Judy, Bill, Pat, the Waters, Cooley, and Smith families. I invite your prayers for those who live in poverty or homelessness, insecurities of any kind? How about your prayers for those who live in mourning? I invite your prayers for the church, for those who minister, for those who serve. I invite your prayers for those who have died, remembering especially Nancy, Paul, and John. Kilmer, Jane. For what else and whom else shall we pray? Lord God, hear the prayers of your people, those which we have given voice, those which we hold in the silence of our hearts, and those for which we have yet to find words. We entrust these to you who knows better than ourselves our deepest needs, offered in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Continuing on page 7, whoever is on the Lord's side, let them join with me, that we may come to the visions of God. Together, create a clean heart within me, O God, so that may become your chosen shelter and the resting place of the Holy Spirit. I make the cross of Christ upon my breast, over the tablet of my heart, and I beseech the living God of the universe, may the light of life come to my dark heart, so that I may live in the power of your love. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us everlasting life.
Amen. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give to you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of that kingdom where you live forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with your spirit.
You are visiting us, we are so glad to have you here this evening. This just brings joy to my heart. The service itself, as you have figured out, is the Celtic service, and just a little bit of background on that. The Celtic liturgy itself really embraces this sense that God is with us and very, very imminent. And this is revealed in nature, it's revealed in our lives, and that everything is a window into this kingdom of God that we talk about. And the other piece is that there tends to be a on the Trinity and on this relationship of God, and we find that throughout the Celtic worship here as well. A couple of things to, first of all, words of thanksgiving for our musicians and for our vocalists. We are very glad to have you here this evening and add so much richness for Hugh and for Stephen and for Ken and for Michael, our musicians, for Addison. Is it Addie or Addison? Either is fine. Addison and Allison, we are so glad to have you here with us as well. Some of you all are students, aren't you? From Georgia College. Right, wonderful. We are so glad to have you here this evening. A couple of things I would like to lift up here. We have hired a new parish administrator. In fact, she's here this evening, Brinkley Pound. This is, I think, Brinkley and Jim's first venture out on a Saturday evening, and we are glad to have you at this service. And Brinkley, I'll speak on behalf of you, or for you, that she's been the executive director for over a year now at the Habitat for Humanity in Greene County, and that's a full-time position. She's missing her grandkids a bit. She's looking for something more part-time, and she's always wanted to do this kind of work in the church. And Brinkley, you are imminently overqualified for this, and we are so glad to have you with us starting early on in October. Thank you. We're glad to have you. The other thing I'd like to lift up is that we had our Father's Kitchen opportunity to serve today, and 105, is that 105?
105.
Three digits there, about 105 meals, including those that go out to folks who are housebound. We had 10 volunteers. It sounded like it was a fun and glorious morning and early afternoon for you.
Yep.
Yes. So thank you. The need continues to be great. This is any signs that there's any shift in that? We see this need. And just so folks know, our Father's Kitchen was created by four churches initially. We have now five churches who are contributing to this along with Second Harvest. And this free meal is given out every Saturday from 11 o'clock until 1 o'clock to anybody. Anytime. Come on by. It really is an interesting time together. I'd also like to lift up the ECW, the Episcopal Church Women, are meeting on Monday, 2 days from now, at the home of Frank and Kathy Crosby at 11 o'clock. There'll be a conversation, discussion about labyrinths, of all things, and then a meal after that. It's not too late to sign up if you'd like to come. Just let me know, or you can let Elizabeth Hassel know, or Danelle Borland. They would be glad to have you join us on Monday. That's what I've got here. There is a lot of other good pieces of information in this bulletin. I will commend that to your own attention. Is there anything else for the greater good? Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries to celebrate this upcoming week? Or have we missed somebody? Well, we now are heading into that portion of our service that is the Holy Communion. And please know this, everyone is welcome to this altar. Everyone is welcome to this rail. If it would be new for you to do so, then come on forward. Just put your hands out like this, and you will receive a consecrated piece of the bread, this little wafer. And we are still not drinking from the common cup. We are dipping into this. We are what we call intinking. And so don't put that piece of bread in your mouth yet. Hold on to it until the chalice comes by, and then do the intinking. Well, we'll start here in the front, and we'll kind of work towards our back as well. Since Dana, you're going to be starting us off here, I thought you might like to know that little piece of information. Well, then walk in love as Christ loves us, and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice unto God. The Lord be with you.
And also with your spirit.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. You, O Father, with your only begotten Son and the Holy Spirit are God. You are God, one and mortal. You are God, incorruptible and unmoving. You are God, invisible and faithful. You are God, wonderful and worthy of praise. You are God, strong and worthy of honor. You are God, most high and magnificent. You are God, living and true. You are God, wise and powerful. You are God, holy and splendid. You are God, great and good. You are God, awesome and peace-loving. You are God, beautiful and righteous. You are God, pure and kind. You are God, blessed and just. You are God, tender and holy. You are God, not in the singularity of one person, but in the trinity of substance. Together, we believe in you, we bless you, we adore you, and praise your name forevermore. We praise you through Christ, who is the salvation of the universe, through Christ, who is the life of human beings, through Christ, who is the resurrection of the dead. Through him the angels praise your majesty, the dominions adore, the powers of the heaven of heavens tremble, the virtues and the blessed seraphim can celebrate in exultation. So grant, we pray you, that our voices may be admitted to that of the chorus in humble declaration of your glory as we sing. We humbly pray and implore you, for Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, to be pleased to receive and bless these gifts, these holy and unblemished offerings. We offer them to you in the first place, for your holy church throughout the world. Be pleased to keep her in peace, to watch over her, and to gather her in unity and guide her, and also for Robert, your servant, our bishop, and all bishops and all right-believing teachers of the one holy Catholic and apostolic faith. Being in fellowship, we reverently bring to mind first the glorious Mary, ever virgin, mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and then your blessed apostles, martyrs, and all your saints. Grant by their merits and prayers that at all times we may be defended and helped by your protection. Through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, to bless this offering, to accept it fully, to make it perfect and worthy to please you, that it may become for us the body and blood of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the day before he suffered, took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and with his eyes lifted up to heaven to you, God, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed, broke, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat you all of this, for this is my body." In like manner, after he had supped, taking also this chalice into his holy and venerable hands, and again giving thanks to you, he blessed and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink you all of this. For this is the chalice of my blood, of the new and eternal testament, the mystery of faith, which shall be shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. As often as you shall do these things, you shall do them in memory of me." Wherefore, O Lord, in memory of the blessed passion of the same Christ, your Son, our Lord, of his resurrection from among the dead, and of his ascension to heavenly glory, We, your servants, and with all your holy people, offer to your sovereign majesty from among your gifts bestowed upon us the holy bread of everlasting life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a favorable and gracious countenance. Accept them as you were pleased to accept the offering of your servant Abel, the sacrifice of our father Abraham, and that of Melchizedek, your high priest, a holy sacrifice. We humbly implore you, Almighty God, that these offerings be carried by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, that all who are partakers at the altar of the precious body and blood of your Son may be filled with all heavenly grace and blessing, through the same Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Remember also, Lord, your servants and handmaids who have gone before us, who are marked with the sign of faith and sleep the sleep of peace. To them, Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, grant, we implore you, a place of happiness, light, and peace, through the same Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
To us also, your sinful servants, who hope in the multitude of your mercies, be pleased to grant some place in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints. We pray you admit us into their company, not weighing our merits, but bestowing on us your own free pardon. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Through him, O Lord, you create these good things, and you allow, quicken, and bless him as gifts for us. By him, and with him, and in him, are ever given to you, God the Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. As our Savior taught us, we boldly pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Deliver us before you, Lord, from all evils, past, present, and to come. And mercifully give peace in our days, that through the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin and safe from all troubles. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
O Lord, we believe that this broken bread in your broken body, and the pouring out of this wine in your poured out blood, we become your redeemed people. We confess that in taking the gifts of this pledge here, we lay hold and hope of enjoying its true fruits in the heavenly places. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Jesus gives heavenly bread to the hungry, and to the thirsty, water from the living spring. Come. Body of Christ. the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Thank you. Together as one, there are people. Amen.